Garrett Samuel is a science educator and frequent contributor to the Thunderbolts project. He also produces an outstanding video series on electric universe theories that aims at the very heart of science. He chose the perfect title for his YouTube channel, and you should check it out. It's called See the Pattern. If a repeating pattern emerges from nature, we should recognize it as significant. To truly understand it, we should be able to explain its cause and effect and reproduce it. Seeing the pattern and discovering its cause and effect is what science is all about. The proof is in recreating the pattern, not by subjectively programmed and data-fixed mathematical models, but by physical demonstration of the physics involved. This essay presents a challenge for those with a knack for playing with electricity. I'm going to show you a pattern. I call it the Keystone Pattern because it's a pattern of key significance, and its effect can be found in geology, so it's written in stone. It's a pattern that results from electrical discharge. I'll show you this pattern and explain it in the best plain language I can, and then it'll be up to you to reproduce it. It shouldn't be hard. In fact, it's been done before. You may know the pattern as the crooked smile if you followed the electric universe for several years. Michael Steinbacher and Billy Elverton produced the pattern in the image shown. I believe it was Michael that called it the crooked smile. I'm giving it a new name, the Keystone name, because the smile is only part of the pattern. Michael intuitively understood this pattern was the result of a multi-phase discharge. He was trying to reproduce the shape of Valles Marineris on Mars. He assumed correctly that by creating a discharge in Billy's laboratory with the proper setup, they could reproduce Valles Marineris, and they did. Unfortunately, they didn't explain their experimental setup, so we'll have to guess. My guess is they laid a metal plate on a table to form one electrode. They covered the metal plate with a dielectric plate, probably glass or plastic, to add resistance and enhance the reactive power. Then they hung another electrode a few inches above the plate and covered the plate in sand. I believe they then took two leads from a three-phase power source, stepped into high voltage, and connected one lead to the plate and one lead to the hanging electrode, creating a point-to-plane electric field between two out-of-phase circuits. The pattern is caused by electrical induction currents that spread out in the horizontal plane from the vertically oriented multi-phase discharge between the electrodes. These type of induction currents are called reactive power currents. You can think of it like aiming a fire hose at the floor. The stream of water from the nozzle is an analogy for the vertical discharge current. In terms of electricity, we call that real power because it's going where we want it. The water that splashes from the floor are reactive currents, or reactive power currents in the case of electricity, that are splashing across the electrode plate. The stream of water hitting the floor is like electric current hitting resistance. Reactive power is the energy of currents that gets redirected by the resistance. The splash pattern that reactive power makes is peculiar and very specific to electromagnetism. Unlike water that splashes away vectored by kinetic energy and gravity, an electric current generates moving electric and magnetic fields that vector its reactive energy. So it generates a repeating fractal pattern. Reproducing in the lab is as compelling as scientific evidence can get. It's also compelling when you can find it in nature over and over again. We're going to use it to identify several electrical craters here on Earth, and doing so dispel the silly notion that Earth has been bombarded by asteroids and comets. This image shows the Keystone pattern again, only this time I've annotated certain features over the Billy Elverton, Michael Steinbacher experiment. The pattern occurs over the duration of the discharge while it is in contact with the ground and making a complete circuit. Over time, the voltage vector of reactive power shooting out from the focal point rotates around the pattern like the second hand of a clock, pointing to all points on the compass. Only it sweeps around counterclockwise instead of clockwise. The current that follows this voltage vector lags behind it, like the minute hand of the clock chasing the second hand, but never catching up. At the same time, magnetic fields are pulsing outward in concentric waves from the focal point and inducing current to follow it. This sets up an interference pattern of positive and negatively charged regions around the circle formed by the induced currents, where the sand grains, which also carry charge, are either attracted or repelled. It's much like a cymatic pattern created by a particular frequency of vibration, only this is caused by induced out-of-phase currents, where the charge on the plate is the same as the sand. The sand is levitated away, which is technically called sputtering. And it's levitated to a region of opposite charge, where it sticks to form a mountain. Within the image, the red cross represents primary reactive currents that splash at particular vectors from the discharge focused at the center of the X. C is a filament of electrical induction or capacitive reactive current. The one marked L is a filament of magnetic induction reactive current. The green dashed circle that surrounds the formation represents stray capacitance generated in concentric rings around the focus of the discharge made by magnetic fields. These are rings of step potentials that are expressed as hills and valleys, mountains, or crater rims in geologic formations. The blue lines shown are the crooked smile that portray induction currents that follow the electric or magnetic fields, or both. On the left-hand quadrant formed by the red X, the electric field induction dominates and the current flows straight to the encircling ring and makes a 90-degree turn to follow parallel to the ring because the capacitor ring is a standing potential wave in the electric field. The quadrant on the right is the magnetic induction-dominated region, so the current streams out perpendicular to magnetic field lines induced by the magnetic field. These lines intersect the green rings at 90 degrees. In the center, through the top quadrant, are bars of blue. The bars are unipolar winds that drag straight across the focal point of the discharge. They probably aren't truly unipolar winds, they're plasma winds, but they're heavily ionized, and so they move extremely fast across the center of the discharge. They're probably the easiest feature to identify for reactive power currents. The crooked smile is a fractal circuit pattern of capacitive and inductive eddy currents in these particular quadrants of reactive power. The direction of current flow can go either way, depending on polarity, so I don't usually show arrows in the diagrams. In the top and bottom quadrants formed by the red X are where reactive currents form updrafts and downdrafts. The yellow star shown in the top quadrant is a downdraft current, and the pale green swirl in the bottom quadrant is an updraft. These would be tornadoes and downbursts of plasma wind and lightning. They generally leave circular patterns of depressions or hills. The next image shows the same features more fully annotated. Note how the right side magnetic induction currents, marked IL, meet the encircling capacitance at 90 degrees, while on the left, capacitive induction currents, marked IC, bend 90 degrees to parallel the encircling capacitance. Note also that the upper half of the right and left quadrants are more inductive, with tendrils crossing perpendicularly to the encirclement, and the lower halves are more capacitive, with parallel flows. The upper half also has currents flowing upward towards the top of the circle, whereas in the bottom half, the currents parallel and flow downward toward the bottom of the circle. The difference is leading and lagging currents that are either following or leading the electric field. The left or capacitive quadrant will sometimes also develop Z-shaped currents, with currents alternating its vector between magnetic and electric fields. The top and bottom quadrants produce up and down currents that circle the crux of the discharge in a ring or toroidal current. The yellow star and green swirl are the face and footprint of this current. For those interested in math and fractals, phasors are calculated with complex numbers. The complex numbers have irrational number multipliers in the equations that apply to these top and bottom quadrants. The action of eddy currents is better understood with the following GIF illustration that portrays the magnetic flux generated by the discharging current. The left-hand side of this compare image shows the field lines of magnetism created along the ground plane at 90 degrees to the discharge. The right-hand side has black lines indicating the path of induced reactive eddy currents that are created by this moving magnetic flux. I first discovered the pattern while examining the Laramie Mountains in Wyoming. The pattern can be a crater or a mountain, depending on polarity. I published two articles on these mountains last year. It wasn't until this year I recognized the pattern I found was the same as Michael's crooked smile. The Laramie pattern was caused by a plasma mesocyclone, with its central updraft representing the real power discharge, the fire hose current, in other words. A positive ion current flowing up from the ground into the storm. The ground was negatively charged, and so positive ionic matter from the winds collected there by static attraction, adhering to form the mountains. The mountains retain the shape of the winds, like a sand dune does, except for the influence of electromagnetism that formed the Keystone pattern. The pattern can be quantified and mapped with something called a phasor diagram. Phasors are 3D graphs of vectors. For electrical circuits, they're used to determine the amplitude and direction of energy flow or power at a given time. In an alternating current multiphase system, there are two or more waves out of phase with each other. Phasors are used to determine the resultant vector for the flow of power, voltage, and current when there are multiple waves. Man-made circuits work best when the energy sent down the wires is aimed straight and doesn't splash. Although some reactive power is needed, unwanted splashing is inefficient. It shows up as heat loss, signal noise, and can even create plasma streamers from high voltage power connections. We manage this with physical things like insulation, capacitors, transformers, and generators to control frequency and amplitude and maximize what is called the real power, the fire hose power, as opposed to the reactive power or splashing. Nature lets energy splash all over the place, and it results in plasma winds, storms, and tornadoes. It also results in rock and mountain formation. The next image you'll recognize is the Richat structure. The compare image shows the basic Keystone pattern features. The wind direction is verified, where possible, by the triangular faces of tetrahedral hills formed by supersonic shockwaves, and rock dikes that are not marked on this image, caused by wind and shockwave. The Richat was created by a plasma tornado spinning like a buzzsaw between two opposing jet streams. Tornadoes have a downstreaming core wind inside the spinning updraft. A tornado, electrically, is called a Markland current, and it has a central core downdraft of ionic wind. That's why tornado genesis begins with a descending column of condensate meeting a rising swirl of dust. It's a connection being made, a downcoming leader meeting an upcoming riser from the ground, to complete a circuit of opposing positive and negative current flows. The Keystone pattern, in the case of the Richat, was caused by induction winds that hugged the ground, being fed by the core downdraft that blew out beneath the updrafting whirlwind. The next images show the wind pattern of the whirlwind and the shock waves that resulted from the induction winds crossing under the whirlwinds. The winds cross orthogonally and leave cross-hatched shock features. The Shoemaker crater in Australia provides another example of the Keystone pattern. The crater doesn't show signs of rotation on the ground, like the Richat does, but the red cross of induced ground currents formed a rock dike that is fairly pronounced, as are wind pattern mountains at the green encircling ring of capacitance forming the crater rim. Induction features can be either anodic or cathodic. If the ground is charged negative and a wind full of positive ionic matter blows over, a mountain of adhering matter will form. If the negative ground is exposed to a ground-to-ground discharge, it will sputter or blast earth away and leave a depression. If the ground has positive matter in it, that will suck to the discharge and fuse to form a rock dike. Examples of rock dikes formed by ground currents are shown in the next images. Anode and cathode features will appear alternately as current passes through the encircling rings of capacitance, making interference patterns in the hills and crater rims. If you're wondering, do you find these patterns on the moon? No, Lunar craters are from direct current DC charges because the moon is not alive with a geomagnetic field like Earth is. Earth is a multi-phase circuit, and these patterns result from multi-phase alternating current interactions. There are several craters that exhibit the fast unipolar winds crossing the crater rims caused by induction across the blue bar. Here are three in the next collage of images. The striations cross in each of these images show that winds crossed right across the center top of each of these craters. No one crater exhibits every feature perfectly. Some features are covered by sand, water, farms, and cities. Some have eroded, and some simply don't develop in every condition. The patterns develop from reactive currents in both the air and ground. There is, however, pattern consistency when several features are evident in the correct position with respect to the quadrants of the phaser. Here are several craters from around the Earth, most of them falsely attributed to meteors. They are the result of a discharge current flowing between Earth and sky. All exhibit aspects of the Keystone pattern. Note the Q in each ring. At roughly the 5 o'clock position, each crater exhibits a hook-shaped slash or other anomaly through the ring. Of course, I've oriented the pictures so they are consistent, but note that there is also similarity in the pattern of river channels connecting to the ring to either side of the Q mark. So there is a quick and dirty way to identify the Keystone pattern. Just look for the Q with a lightning bolt through it. Truth is always holistic. We've been trained to think our consciousness is constrained to the brain. It's not.